Breathless in awe and wonder, the King of Glory, the King of Glory. that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King of all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Won't you stand with us and sing Worthy, Worthy is the Lamb who is slain.
Worthy is the Lamb who is slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who is slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who is slain.
Behold our King,
nothing can compare. Come, let us adore Him. Has given counsel to the Lord. Who can question any of His words? Who can teach the one who knows all things? Who can fathom all His wondrous deeds? Behold our God, seated on His throne. Come, let us adore Him. Behold our King, nothing.
Let's pray. Father, thanks so much for this morning. Thanks that we could come. Thanks that we could be here, that we could just meet you, that we could worship, that we could sing. And God, I pray as we continue into your word, God, speak to us. God, I pray that even as we begin, you know, God, Psalm 36 is on my heart all week, just for us to realize and to know this about you. Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens. Your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mountains of God. Your judgments are like the great deep. Man and beast you save, O Lord. How precious is your steadfast love, O God. The children of mankind take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. For with you is the fountain of life, in your light do we see light. Oh, continue your steadfast love to those who know you, and your righteousness to the upright of heart. Look not, Lord, let not the foot of arrogance come upon me, nor the hand of the wicked drive me away. There the evildoers lie fallen. They are thrust down, unable to rise. And Father, I pray that we would experience your love this morning, that you would give us eyes to see and ears to hear. God, we invite you in to our time. We invite your love and your passion for us into our hearts and into our time this morning. So, Father, calm the distractions. We ask that you'd bring a peace to our hearts and minds, and we pray against the distractions. We pray against the kingdom of darkness. We pray against the wicked and the lies and the things that are going on in our heads and our hearts. So, Father, we invite you in. We love you, Jesus. Amen. All right. Well, thanks for being here this morning. I hope you enjoyed our time of worship. As we get started this morning, we're going to look at a topic called deception. And we're going to look at how it plays out in your life and plays out in my life. And everyone deals with this. Every single person sitting in this room deals with this word on many levels. And so we want to kind of dive into a little bit. So we're going to look at a bunch of passages of Scripture, but you can kind of camp out at Genesis chapter 3 for a little bit. And we're going to start there. And we're just going to walk in. Deception, if you look it up by definition, is the act of deceiving somebody, the act of deceiving someone. So as we jump into that, keep that in mind. So let's start in Genesis 3, and we're going to just kind of start at verse 1, kind of walk our way through it here. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God actually say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden? Now, we know that the stage to set this up, this conversation between Eve and the serpent, was that God had put Adam and Eve in the garden, and God had told them that they could eat of any tree except for one, the knowledge of good and evil, and that was the one they were not to eat or touch. Okay, so everything else was good to go. Well, we see here that the evil one comes in and says, did God actually say, you shall not eat of the tree, of any tree in the garden? Now, to kind of set a little bit also stage on who the evil one is, John 8:48 says that he's the father of all lies. John 10:10 says he is here to steal, kill, and destroy. That's his mission. That's what he wants to do. We also can see in 1 Peter 5:8 that he's a roaring lion seeking to devour. He wants to take people out. We also see in Ephesians 6:10, some scriptures will be up on the screen, but Ephesians 6:10 through 12. And we want to take a quick look at that one. Ephesians 6:10 through 12 says this: finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Look at the next one. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. Now, Paul's right in this. He's writing this in a letter to the church of Ephesus. And he says, guys, listen, you need to put on the full armor of God. And he goes into that. Here's why. Because you are going to have to stand against the schemes of the devil. And so that's huge. We got to understand that we're kind of in a war here, right? For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. That is what we're up against in this world. As a believer, this is what you are fighting against, okay? So this is the war that we are in, and we need to understand that about what's going on. And this was the war that Eve was in, okay? When the evil one came, he said, did God actually say this? And so we want to expose this morning deception. Now, how many of you watched Super Bowl 49? Okay, we got quite a few of you. The end did not quite end the way I wanted it to. Okay? And it might not have for many, so you already know who I'm going for. But you got Russell Wilson dropping back, right, on the one-yard line. This is like, what is it, second and one. It's like, all right, they can do this, okay? They absolutely can do this. Lots of debate on whether they should have thrown, ran, whatever. But Russell Wilson drops back, quick throw, almost like the rookie Butler was his wide receiver. It was such a good pass, okay? Here's what happened, though. And there were some reports that even as a rookie, this young man studied the tape. He knew the plays. He jumped on that before the play had almost even begun. This young man knew his opponent. He knew what was going on. He knew how they were going to attack. When he figured out what play was happening, he was there to win the game, to win the Super Bowl as a rookie. He understood the opponent. So this morning, we want to expose the opponent. We want to expose this war that we are in. We want to expose the tactics, the schemes of the evil one that we're against, because he has claimed the world. This is his playground. Colossians chapter 2, verse 8 says this: "See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to the human traditions, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ." This is his playground, and he has put in belief systems in our world and all kinds of things. And again, Paul's saying, you know what? See to it that no one takes you captive. So we got to understand, what is the opponent? What are the schemes? What is his goal? What does he try to do? So let's go back to Genesis 3 and kind of see how this plays out. So he said to the woman, did God actually say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden? It's quite a question. It's a play on words. It's a play on statement that God had spoken to them. So the woman then, you can see, kind of goes, okay. And the woman said to the serpent, well, we may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. So Eve's kind of playing through, well, this is what God actually said. And then the serpent said to the woman, and comes back, you shall surely not die. For God knows when you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was a delight to the eyes and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise. She took of its fruit and ate, and she gave it to her husband, who was with her, and ate. Just play the conversation out in your mind. It's incredible, so subtle, but it comes to a point of deception. The very end, God comes and goes, hey guys, where are you, right? They're hiding. They realize they were naked. They're hiding. God goes, hey, where are you? Well, God knew where they were, but he was pursuing them. He already knew they screwed up, but he was pursuing them. And in the end, Eve goes, I was deceived by the serpent. And that deception is rooted in all of us. We battle against that every single day. See, within deception and within the lies of the evil one, who's the father of all lies, what we have is not just deception, but there's also a message that comes with that deception. For Eve, the deception was, oh, you'll be like God. You'll be like God. Well, that was a lie, right? That was an absolute lie. And here was the message. She began to distrust the heart of God. She began to go, that fruit does look pretty good. You can play it out in your mind, right? I wonder why God would have told me not to eat. Well, maybe I would be like God, and he doesn't want me to be like him. Eve began to distrust the heart of God. There's a lie and deception. Oh, you'll be like God. And the message attached to that is, you can't trust God. He doesn't want what's best for you. And we'll play that out as we go through this morning. But Eve has this like conversation, and you can, you know, think through the thoughts. And this plays out very practical for us. Plays out very practical. Pastor Dan talked about last week how when someone comes to Christ, you're a new creation, there's a new heart, your heart is now good, you're all things, you're new. But in Romans chapter 12, Romans chapter 12. There's one area that still needs some work, right? It says this: I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. And then verse 2 says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Your mind. It's right here. The renewal of your mind is absolutely key in your walk with God, right? In the morning, if you're a new creation, you wake up and you go, okay, God, I want to serve you. I want to obey you. I don't want to sin today. Help me. I need you, God. I want to follow and listen and hear what you want me to do. And then have you ever got to the end of the day, and you look back and you thought, what happened? I sinned here. It's like that was not my heart. That was not my desire when I got up, but somehow I ended up here. So we go before the Lord and we confess sin and we're so thankful for his forgiveness and grace. But what practically happened throughout my day or your day that is so key? It's right here. It's the battle for your mind. And the battle is deception versus truth. See, none of us got up this morning without going, I'm going to go to church. I don't raise my hand without my brain telling it to. Everything goes through here. Everything. Every thought, everything that you do. So throughout our day, we don't sin without thinking first. We don't sin without thinking. It's the battle for your mind. And inside, every single sin or temptation is deception. Guaranteed. So what's the deception? Well, and how do we deal with that? Look at 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 5. 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 5, absolutely important. Says this: for though we walk in the flesh, we are not waging war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but of divine power to destroy strongholds. Now that word strongholds can be translated as a place or foothold. It's the same thing in Ephesians chapter 4 where Paul says, hey, do not give the devil a foothold. He's talking to Christians. The evil one, can create footholds and strongholds in our lives. He says, don't do that. And here's how, right? Have divine power to destroy those strongholds. We'll talk more about that. Let's go to verse 5. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God. Every single idea, every single opinion, every single argument that goes against God, we have the ability to absolutely and completely destroy. And he says this, and take every thought captive. Every thought. How many of you are hungry right now? Okay, we may go a little long. Not because you're hungry. Because we started a little late. Right? You're hungry. Take that thought captive. Are you really hungry? Think about it. Are you really hungry? And I'm not talking about, you know, like there's people that don't have anything to eat and so we can't call ourselves hungry because they're starving. I'm not saying that. I'm very practically, take every thought captive. Make sure that it's true. Because the battle is for your mind. The evil one is throwing lies at you from this world, from himself. And every single thought we take captive to obey Christ. Well, how does that even play out more when we talk about we can destroy and we have power and we have all this? Well, let's look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18 through 22. And this is incredible. Having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might. Love it. He has a power that's working in us. And here's what the power is like. Let's go on to verse 20. That he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places. So here's what you have. Paul here is saying that the power that raised Christ from the dead is the same power that is working in you. Now, I got a question. In your day, from the time you get up to the time you go to bed, guess what? We all sin and we all have sin issues. Do you think the power that raised Christ from the dead can also have this enough power to overcome your sin? We don't have to walk around defeated because we have the same power that raised Christ from the dead in us, and that's pretty incredible. Take note of this. Where is Christ? When he raised him from the dead, he put him at the right hand. Where? In the heavenly places. Now let's keep going. Verse 21 says this. Far above, this is where Christ is, right hand, heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion. Those are all words for the evil one and his army. And above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. Verse 22. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church. Everything. There is not anything that is above Jesus. Jesus is over it all, even the kingdom of darkness. Jesus has more power than. Okay, now, take a look at this. Ephesians 2, 6. So that's the end of the chapter. We jump ahead to chapter 2, 1, 2, just a few verses. It says, and he raised us up. If we're in Christ, he raised us up and seated us with him where? In the exact same place, in the heavenly places, in Christ Jesus. Oh my goodness, what is that? Where does that put us? That puts us in the same seat of Christ. Now, not in and of ourselves, but because of Christ, in Christ Jesus, we are also seated above everything else. And as a child of God, we have authority in Christ, just like he does. We have authority over the kingdom of darkness. We have authority over the evil one. We have authority over his schemes. We have authority over his lies. We have authority over his deceptions. Now just think about how that can play out in your life if you begin to believe that you actually have the authority to say no, to fight. And in Christ, it's incredible. The battle's right here, deception versus truth. Behind every lie, or behind every sin, there's deception. There is a lie. 1 Corinthians 10:13 tells us, right, that God always provides a way of escape from our temptation. Well, he does. It's called truth. It's called the authority that he's given us. We have the authority. We have the truth to combat it all. We'll practically play this out for a moment. Right? In our marriages, thoughts could go through your head. Well, if he or she only did this, then I'd be happier. Thoughts like, hey, you know, if I just had a different husband or wife, it would probably work out better. Could go into pornography. It'll satisfy you. You know what? I haven't met one single person 5 minutes after they got done with pornography that said they were satisfied. It's the lie. It's the deception. Gossip. Well, if I just tell, I'll just tell one person, and we even spiritualize it really well so they can pray. Or I'll just, I can trust that person because, they said they won't tell anyone, so when was the last time that worked? Practically speaking, guys, we face deception all the time. The battle for our mind. It's an illustration, you know, just walking through New York City, just as an illustration, walking through New York City, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. I know that sounds really dumb. Why would you do that? Just go with me, okay? So you're walking through and you come across an alley. A guy jumps out, puts a gun to your head. He needs money. He's a drug addict. With a gun to your head, who has authority? Who has authority in that moment? Right? The guy with the gun. Okay? Well, out of nowhere, you see someone come down and just grab the gun and run, so you take off and run. Okay? So the next night, again, go with the illustration. I don't know why you do this. You go out, 2 o'clock in the morning, go down the same path, same alleyway. This guy jumps out. And you see him put his hand in the shape of a gun to your head. Who has authority? You do. But let me ask you a question. The moment you begin to believe this is a gun, who has authority? He does. Now, the evil one in our life is really, really good at making things look like he has the authority. He's really good at making sin look good. He's really good at making you think this is a gun. It's the battle for your mind. It's the battle for your mind. That's how it plays out in our daily life. But see, Jesus said, the truth will set you free. The truth sets us free. It's incredible. Guys, this plays out in everything. It plays all the way out into, you know, my kids wanting to put their hand in the cookie jar illustration, right? When we tell them don't. It's the same principle with Eve. Don't eat. Don't touch this. And the lies begin to come. Guys, this concept even goes deeper. And I want to take us even a little bit deeper this morning. You see, every single one of us has been wounded in some way. Hurt. Maybe when we were 4, all the way up to just recently. We've all been wounded, whether it's by harsh words, maybe bullied, treated unfairly, through divorce, through abuse, physical, emotional, verbal, sexual. Maybe it was when you were little and your parents got divorced. We've all been wounded. We don't like to go there. But guys, inside every single wound is deception. Inside every single wound is a message. It's a poison. In Ephesians chapter 6 says this, verse 16, talks about this, in all circumstances, this is the armor of God, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. Right? In the middle of our lives, in the middle of life, in the middle of any event, small or big, there's darts firing right into the middle of those hurts and those pains that have deception and messages and poison connected to it. And what begins to happen is you begin to form a belief system about yourself in that wound. Worked with a young man, counseled a young man who's in another state. He was a newly married, less than a year. And it came out that he had already been pursuing women, other women. Even up to 5 or 6, 7. When it all came out, it was actually up to 16. Through social media, through sexting, through all kinds of things. So I began to counsel with him, began to work with him, began to spend time, pray through some things with him. And here's what came out. As a young man, he struggled to become a man because his dad never treated him as though he was never good enough. Now, we're not sitting here going, well, it's all the dad's fault. That's not at all what we're saying. That was an event. That was a wound. Okay? Here's what happened. The evil one shot a dart right into the middle of his wound in his heart that said, you're only a man if you're with women. He began to pursue it, even in high school. And the more that he pursued it, the more that he felt like a man. And he got to the place where it wasn't, I don't just need one woman, I need many. And can I tell you, when we walked into that with him and the Lord spoke into the middle of it and brought truth, he was set free. His marriage is unbelievable right now. There's a young lady who was married who, again, another state, she just could not make sense of death and things like, you know, how could a loving God allow this to happen? How could a loving God allow this or whatever? And events would happen and she got to the place where she's just like, I don't trust God, I don't get it. Began to press in, and her brother drowned in a pond when she was really young. It's an accident. It's the casualty of this world, the brutality of our world, death. That's going to happen, but the evil one shot a dart right into the middle of that, in that moment, in that event, said, God doesn't love. You can't trust him. And her belief system and how she began, even through middle school and high school and then on into marriage, that was her belief system that just grew. She came to a place that it just boiled into her relationships and on. And so we asked the Father to speak into those things, and she's a different woman today. See, events take place. Satan throws these darts right into the heart, right into your heart, and in the middle of it. And in those moments, we begin to believe these lies and this deception. And then it forms into messages about ourselves. Messages like this: I'm worthless. I'm worthless. Messages like, God doesn't care or love me. And we spiritualize all of this. Well, yeah, God does. But at the core, inside of us, these are rooted. Messages like, I can never trust anyone again. Messages, I'm unlovable. I'm unlovable. There's people in this room right now who believe these things about themselves. I'm unlovable. I have to figure everything out on my own. I have to earn God's love because of what happened to me or because of what I did. I can't trust God. I'm not valuable. We could go on and on. My life's not worth living. So the messages and the lies that Satan, the deception that he wants us to buy into, because if we buy into these, we become defective for the kingdom. And we live with these and we believe these, and they become that belief system in us. And then it affects how we live our lives out. It affects our marriages. It affects our parenting. It affects our friendships. It affects and the ripples. It's like throwing a stone into a pond, and it just keeps going. It's a battle right here. It's a battle for your mind. in the middle of events, in the middle of death, in the middle of harsh words, confrontation, hardships in marriage, hardships in parenting, all of those things. The arrows just keep coming with messages and deception. 2 Corinthians 11:3 says this, "But I am afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, your thoughts will be led astray from the sincere and pure devotion of Christ." We don't sin without believing a lie first. You don't sin without being deceived. We're really, really good at spiritualizing these things. We're really good at looking at some of the things in our past and just sealing off the wound, and it kind of scabs over and we just keep going. But the ripples are still there. This morning I want to ask the Father to re-enter into some of those. What lies are you believing? See, 2 weeks ago Dan talked about the hearing the voice of God. Do you guys want freedom? Freedom? It's incredible. We can be deceived and held captive, or we can be set free. But you know what? We got to go into it. Freedom comes from truth. Freedom comes from hearing the voice of God. Freedom comes from activating our authority in Christ. That's where freedom comes from. The abundant life that God promises and wants us to have comes from hearing his voice and the truth and exercising our authority, because buying in lies just captivates us, makes us captive and held down and held back. And freedom from the belief systems that pull us down, freedom from maybe believing I'm unlovable, freedom from believing that I can't trust God. Freedom from believing that I'm not valuable, that I can't trust anyone. Freedom from that daily sin that I keep falling into. It's offered to us. It's offered to us. And just like Adam and Eve in the garden, the Father just comes and goes, have the life. I'm not here to beat you up. I'm here to offer you my love. Guys, the worship team's going to come up. Here's what I want to challenge you to just take a few moments. I want you to take out your piece of paper, your notes. I know now's the time everybody puts them away. Resist. And what I want you to do is just ask the Father, say, "Father, what lies am I believing? What lies am I believing?" And just write them down. Listen to his voice. Listen to his voice. And as the lies come to your head, write them down. This afternoon when you go home for that afternoon nap, as you go to sleep, maybe just take a few minutes and go, "Father, what lies am I believing?" Tonight, before you go to bed, "Father, what lies am I believing?" And just listen, write them down, and then ask, "Father, what's the truth? What's the truth?" And he will speak. He will speak right into the center of some of your wounds. Guys, go there with the Father. go there with the Father. Settle your hearts just for a few moments right now. Settle your minds. Even as I read this. Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens. Your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mountains of God. Your judgments are like the great deep. Men and beasts you save, O Lord. How precious is your steadfast love, O God. The children of mankind take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the rivers of your delight. For with you is the fountain of life, in your light do we see light. Oh, continue your steadfast love to those who know you, and your righteousness to the upright of heart. Let not the foot of arrogance come upon me, nor the hand of the wicked drive me away. There the evildoers lie fallen, and there they are thrust down, unable to rise. Because I promise you, as you enter into a conversation with the Lord on the lies that you believe, you're going to be bombarded with other arrows, because the evil one doesn't want the body of Christ set free. Fight through it. Just take a minute. Father, what lies am I believing? Have I bought into? What ways have I been deceived?
Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. sound of your great name. The sick are healed and the dead are raised at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Your great name. Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty, my Savior, Defender, you are my King. Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty, my Savior, Defender, you are my King.
Jesus, name of Jesus, Lord, high and lifted up, all the world will praise
your great name. Your great
God, we thank you that you've come and you've saved us. Can't wait for the day where we say, Jesus, you are worthy. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. You're the Son of God. You're high and lifted up. May we remember that as we go through our weeks. May we be a blessing to those who are around us. In your name we pray. Amen. You're dismissed.